Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Vanta, and tonight I have the pleasure to talk to expert yoga expert Ophelia Moore and health coach. Ophelia, welcome.
Thank you. Hi. Hi, Brundusha.
Hi. Ophelia Moore moved from Romania to the US in 2004, and for almost 20 years she has practiced yoga, energy awareness, and healthy living, and now she's sharing her knowledge and expertise with us. Ophelia teaches esoteric yoga, senior yoga, and she's a nutrition coach and Tachyon wellness practitioner. She's certified by ATMAN International Federation of Yoga and Meditation, the University of Integrated Sciences in California, and the Institute for Integrative Nutrition in New York. At the beginning of 2018, Ophelia launched her YouTube channel with recorded live senior yoga classes. So, Ophelia, and I know you for how long? For you've been practicing for almost 30 years yoga. I know you for probably almost 30
35 years.
Since I know you, you've been talking and you've been passionate about yoga. And tell me, how did you get into it? What made you? What was the first class? Why did you try it?
I started right after the communists broke in Romania in 1990, and I was absolutely curious about the word. I didn't know too much about what it meant, because yoga, probably very few people know, in communism in Romania was forbidden by law, so it was an underground movement. It was not legal. You didn't know that?
No.
Yes. Yeah, it was probably one of the only country in the world where yoga was forbidden, along with the martial arts and any kind of spirituality. And I know you did some martial arts, right?
Yeah.
But after 1990, yeah, it was also illegal. But after the communists broke, it surfaced and became like a mass movement. Mm-hmm. And I just was very curious about yoga. And I knew it was something with physical activity and kind of gymnastic-like. And just because being very curious about it, I went to a class to see what it was about.
How did you find? Was an ad in? It couldn't be an ad in the newspaper. How did you find about it?
So I just had this thing in my mind: yoga. I need to do yoga. And I had a couple colleagues in high school, which so communists broke right in January, in December of '89, and in March the official classes started. Well, between March and the end of the high school year, which was in June, about 3 weeks, 3 months, mm-hmm. I had two colleagues who joined the class. Probably it was the same class I did, but I don't know now if it was the same class, but I know they said they do yoga. And they started to do some sort of a yoga poses in the class and show us, and they weren't very, very open to talk a lot about it, because as it was an underground movement a few months ago, people weren't so confident to speak very freely about it.
Yep.
But they just said, yoga, and this is what we do, a little bit of stuff. So I got so curious, and I said, how do I find about it? And said, well, look in the fall for posters in town. There'll be posters on poles, and how in Romania at the time, there were poster boards. Look for posters, because they'll start a new class in fall, and you'll find out. So from the moment they told me, I was constantly looking for posters. And eventually in 1990, in September, October, I found the poster that yoga classes start. Mm-hmm. And I was there the first class when I saw the poster, and I never
How
left.
How did you feel the first class? What did you feel?
Oh my God, I was absolutely fascinated. I thought it was exactly what, like, that class was tailored for me.
Uh-huh.
Because I was so... so much in resonated so much with the message of yoga that mm-hmm. it was answering my life quest. So I was only 19 years old, and I can't say I had too much experience at the time.
Yeah.
So but I had existential questions, like who am I, where I come from, what do I do with my life, all kind of spiritual questions. You know, that in communism we are raised atheists, so we didn't believe in God. But still I thought something, it was there. Who was Jesus? And it seems like actually yoga helped me to answer these questions. And it was the first, like a conference presentation. And then the practical classes started. So I just went straight ahead, and I don't think I missed a class for about 5 years.
Wow. So how often, like how many times would you go a week?
Once a week.
Once a week.
Once a week. And because it was such a hunger for spirituality in Romania after all the communism repressions on everything, the classes, when we started the classes in Brasov, I think there were 200 people the first class.
Wow.
And I think in, yeah, I think because we have the Meșteșugul High School.
Uh-huh.
I think that's your high school. You finished high school?
Oh, Shaguna, Shaguna.
You are a Shaguna too. So the Meșteșugul High School, we had the gymnasium, the sports hall, and it was absolutely full. It was, and we didn't have no yoga mats. We had no yoga clothes. Nobody knew what the yoga mats was. I didn't have a yoga mat until 15 years later. I moved in the United States. We did yoga on, we did yoga on blankets and in jeans and in just sweatsuits. Who had said sweatsuits? So it was nothing fancy. It was everything very simple. Mm-hmm. I had my own yoga blanket, my own yoga backpack, and that was my equipment for yoga, and that's how I started.
How many types? I know there are different, a few, several major types of yoga. Like, what did you practice in Romania? What did you practice? What are you practicing in the U.S.? And what are the differences? Can you tell me?
So, there are a few traditional forms of yoga, like Hatha yoga, and this is the one we start in our school. So basically the classes, they're called integrative yoga, or integral, no, the classes in Romania at the time, they're called integral yoga. Now here in the United States, we call it esoteric yoga and sometimes esoteric tantric yoga, depends how people understand the word better, how they refer to it. There are different forms of traditional yoga. For example, Hatha yoga is the most popular one in which you use yoga poses or asanas. Then you have Bhakti yoga, which is a form of devotion, very similar with chanting and adoration of different aspects of energies, feminine, masculine energies. You have Karma yoga, which is the yoga of
selfless action.
Here in this side of the world, we all see it very similar to volunteering, where you do things for others without being waiting for a reward or expecting any reward. Then we have Raja Yoga and Snana Yoga or Yana Yoga, which is our Raja Yoga. It's called the Royal Yoga, which is forms of yoga which require a lot of introspection and forms of very deep meditation. And in our yoga school, as I start to learn, we begin with the Hatha Yoga, but then we learn all the forms of yoga. For example, another one, it's La Yoga. It's a form of meditation with a mantra. Here in this part of the world, is known through the transcendental meditation, the movement, which is very similar. It's not the same thing, but it's very similar using a mantra. In our school, we'd learn La Yoga and eventually give initiation many, many mantras.
Tell me the temperature, because we both don't like hot yoga. What is the ideal temperature in your class? Would be on the cool side, regular temperature?
Actually, the temperature should be where you feel comfortable. Yoga, it's all about feeling good and feeling harmoniously. So you don't want to be in a place reverb on being cold, and your body actually try to generate a lot of heat to warm you up. And you don't want to be very hot, to be sweaty and feel also uncomfortable.
Okay.
So I think
how do you set the temperature in your class when you start a class?
Around 70.
Whatever that means in US, we are in Celsius here. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. About, I don't know, 70 Fahrenheit, probably about around 20 below 20 Celsius degrees, a little bit 18, 18,
okay.
20 degrees.
Now, what advice would you give to someone who never tried but would learn to practice yoga? Do you have any tips for the first time and for beginners?
Yes, and I have a couple tips. First
the
of all,
three. The top please, and then more.
The top how many?
The top three, the most important.
Okay. The most important is when they start yoga to actually ask themselves what they want to begin to practice yoga. For what is their purpose? Is their purpose just to build abs? Is their purpose to look nice, to fit in a special dress for a certain party, which is 6 months ahead? Or they want to practice yoga for their spiritual awakening and for their spiritual purpose. Mm-hmm. Because if they want to practice for a spiritual purpose, then they try to choose a teacher, and they need to start to actually learn about the teacher's background to see what kind of yoga they teach. Where did they learn? What's their education? How did they build up their own education, their own practice? How long they've been practicing? Where do they come from with their yoga practices? If they want to build to practice yoga just for looking good and fitting the dress in 6 months,
they can go to the gym because gym. Yeah.
Gyms offer classes, fitness, yoga, and I'll call it fitness yoga. Yoga always, in any conditions, its practice makes it to look very good. This is a bonus. This is a side effect. It's not the main goal of yoga.
Uh-huh. So now, that's what is yoga? I mean, I know about Ayurveda. So Ayurveda means the science of longevity. What's the meaning of yoga? Like the word
yoga, the word, it means unity. It uh-huh. translates as unity and helps you to become in unity with everything around you. This overused sentence these days, we are all one, basically it is the meaning of yoga, but it needs to be experienced and lived, not only talk about. Mm-hmm. Because the yoga leads you to that feeling that you are all one with everything around you, with everything what is nature, with animals, with plants, with the environment, with the planets, mm-hmm. or with the humans around you. And yoga and should be a lifestyle, not only just the practice. You practice once, 1 hour a week, and that's it. Mm-hmm. Because we talk about yoga and we are in unity for an hour on the mat or 2 hours. And then you get out of the room and somebody parked on the wrong spot or cut your face on the road and you go in a road rage and you go to slash tires or somebody who got your spot or who knows. I heard all kinds of stories among yoga teachers here in town, and sometimes I get shocked. I said, it's hard to understand when you practice yoga to behave like that.
Uh-huh. But did you notice with your clients that are less reactive, less stressful, less anxious, like when they come for a long time to practice, do you kind of change it, more relaxed, less anxiety? Because there is a lot of research on this particular benefit of yoga.
Absolutely, and that's actually the reason I stick with yoga myself. Exactly that, because I was a very hyper child. And yoga helped me to calm down and help me to pull myself together and have a time where I felt extremely relaxed, mm-hmm. and extremely in peace with myself and accepting myself as I was. Because I was in a lot of conflict growing up. You know, yoga wasn't accepted at the time very much in Romania, and I was pulled in all directions. My parents tell me, no, don't go there because you do all this weird stuff, and my heart was telling me to go. I had a lot of friends and I didn't like the groups. And yoga helped me to find that balance, eliminate that anxiety. And anxiety with college, because I went to college and I had to study very hard. And it helped me to concentrate.
It's the hardest, right? Where we went. It's the top two high school, so it's really demanding. I get it.
Yeah, and the college after that. And it helped me to calm down so I can manage the anxiety on the exams and the college much better. It helped me to concentrate so I can learn much faster. So I had actually time to study much faster for my tests, and I didn't have to study 5 hours. Let's say I could study an hour, whatever, just give an example. I had a very much better social interaction with my peers because doing yoga, we were a lot of us who did yoga, but more people who didn't, more students. And again, because wasn't very known at the time, we are mocked a lot. We are bullied a lot. Because I had a certain lifestyle, I had a certain habits, and people didn't understand them. But it helped me to actually cope with that. Mm-hmm. And don't blame them for not understanding me, but allowing me to grow up so I can explain them what I'm doing, that they would become interested in yoga instead of mock it and think it's something weird.
Mm-hmm. So this, you know, feeling this way, this trigger anxiety, this trigger depression. So if other people get these benefits and they try yoga, if they feel like you and they try yoga and they feel better coping with their own thoughts and with others, this alone is a great benefit.
Absolutely, and absolutely, and yogis find their nature are very non-violent beings, and much more accepting and tolerant. Tolerant. I mean, I understand maybe in some societies you might be look very different now. You guys very popular. A lot of people adapt this lifestyle more or less aware. And it's much, you're more accepted. But at the time when nobody knew about yoga, it was such a big difference. And this happens with anything else. You know, if some culture comes and tries to mingle with a different culture, always will be conflicts. But yoga helps you to find a nonviolent resolution to these issues. And always it's a resolution and a solution to every problem. And yoga helps you to find it.
This is what I'm saying. There is at least one solution, usually more than one, to every single problem.
Yes. And yoga gives you this calmness and this ability to see above from the problem. So you don't get involved yourself so much.
We're going to talk about the research. So the reason why you feel so calm is because it's lowering your stress hormone cortisol. And also it's boosting your GABA, the brain chemical responsible for feeling calm and relaxed. So we're going to talk about this. It makes total sense to feel this way. Now, besides your emotions, how do you feel? What other benefits do you see in yourself, like because you're practicing, and in your clients, like joint mobility, pain?
Absolutely. So I'm 48 years old now. I practice since I was 19. And I can tell you, totally honest, the older I get, the better I feel. And I don't have no physical pain whatsoever. Mm-hmm. I used to have back pains quite often. I was extremely tight physical. I mean, my body was very tight. So for me to do yoga.
Like tightness.
I was in pain when I was doing it. First time when I did to the, I was to the first class, I felt I had 1,000 needles in my body. I was only 19. And I was doing ski at the time, and I was doing kind of very active sports, which make your body to become tight. So stretching was exactly the opposite of what I was doing. Mm-hmm. And I was suffering to it, but I felt so good afterwards that that's what brought me back. And absolutely.
So less pain, more stability.
It helps with the back pain, absolutely.
And yeah,
it helps to keep the spine flexible all the way from the tailbone up to the cervical vertebras, because I see in my clients, for example, you know that I'm teaching yoga from a wide range of people, including seniors. And the problems I see in the seniors, their spine freezes, especially from the shoulders, between the shoulder blades up.
Uh-huh.
And they cannot move their neck and head and shoulders. And actually the kidneys and the adrenals are right about below that point. And if they cannot move
the kidneys,
and the adrenals.
You're talking about low back pain, or low back, right?
Yeah, but I'm saying when you curve your back, the kidneys and the adrenals are below that spot where you start. It's right below. So when you curve your back.
But you're talking about low back now.
Yes. Yes, but I'm saying if you freeze your upper back, you cannot actually bend your back. So yeah. You are engaging even these adrenals and the kidneys, and that's the protection against rheumatism and arthritis.
Yeah, so because it cannot affect it. Now, here is with the spine, like the thoracic part, it's somehow protected by the ribs, but this, the neck and the back are the most mobile. We move this a lot in different with different movements, and that's why they are more effective than the other one, the chest, right?
So I do observe that they cannot, basically their spine freezes between the shoulder blades, and they cannot do back bends at all. And not be able to back bends, you are not able to engage this area where below the rib cage, where the adrenals and the kidneys are. And then you don't stimulate them to produce cortisone, natural cortisone, which increases the resistance to rheumatism, increases the resistance to stress. The kidneys and adrenals are super important. So if you cannot keep the spine, is fantastically important. So keeping the spine flexible with yoga practice, it's very, very important. Also the joints, the signs of aging are, it's arthritis, right?
So if you want to, if you do an x-ray, you're going to see signs of like degeneration. Pretty much everybody has.
Yeah, but it is important to be able to keep it to a point that you are functional.
Mm-hmm.
And actually to improve it, because I see in my cases, healing and reversing conditions which I had as a younger woman, which I don't have them anymore. And they disappear from the, for example, I had some tests with my liver when I was about 25, and they told me that my liver looked granular, and it seems like I had probably hepatitis, which wasn't diagnosed. And the woman, the doctor told me at the time, said, probably you're still alive because what you're doing, because your diet, because I was vegetarian, and the mm-hmm. fact that I was doing yoga. And I had all kind of health issues because of that. A lot of skin rashes mm-hmm. and food allergies and all kinds of stuff. And I can tell you, it healed by itself. Mm-hmm. I don't have absolutely no problem with my, because I did all kinds of detoxes and practicing yoga and all this. I'm 100%. I never went back after that. Mm-hmm. But I know all the problems and all the effects I had from that issue is totally resolved. So,
did you see any improvement in any of your clients with heart diseases?
Absolutely.
Because
actually,
there are some studies on, and we're going to talk about it, but I want to see in real life if you have.
Yes. Yes. I did have people come to meditation classes. Mm-hmm. And actually, it was a lady who told me her cardiologist recommended her to go to meditation.
Okay.
And he actually himself, because she had blood pressure, which was very erratic, and they could not control it with medication at all. And he told her, the cardiologist, which in the United States is very rare to happen, but the cardiologist taught her a simple breathing meditation that she was following her breath and tried to calm her down. And she said she could drop her blood pressure 20 points in a few minutes just to that exercise.
Yeah. Meditation improves something, so-called heart variability. So, since you mentioned meditation, how is this related to yoga? Do they work in synergy? Because if you look at the research, they kind of have similar health benefits.
Well,
why are they practiced together?
Because what is called Ashtanga yoga means yoga with eight limbs. Yoga has eight stages.
Mm-hmm.
And meditation is the seventh stage. It's the cherry on the cake.
Okay.
And the eighth is the samadhi, the ecstasy. So we have the first stages, which are yama and yama, the moral and the etic code. Then we have asana, the hatha yoga practice. Then we have pranayama, the breathing techniques. Then
mm-hmm.
we have pratyahara, the withdrawal of the senses, where you can detach from the outside world and you can meditate in it. So you can meditate in any environment and you are not so, you lower your anxiety levels to your environment. Then mm-hmm. you have the ability to concentrate or dharana, so your mind stays focused in one point.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the dhyana, the meditation. So everything, hatha yoga, the yoga practice, it's a preparation for meditation. The meditation itself, it's a goal of yoga. So basically, the yogis develop this path, these stages, so they can meditate for a long time. How can you meditate for a long time if your body aches? If you can stay still for 2 minutes, if your mind jumps like a monkey on all directions, if you cannot detach from the neighbors around you who have the kids playing basketball in your window and stuff like that. So you have to be able to train to meditate. That's why yoga was developed.
Oh, I didn't know. I went straight to meditation. I do meditation and is a heart surgeon, a retired heart surgeon who's doing these classes every Saturday. And doctors are open to meditation and yoga and all the things. So
yeah, not these days we want to use meditation just because our society changed. And because some cultures like Buddhism and Zen, they use less maybe the physical aspect of yoga and they use it under the form of meditation, but still they prepare because even the monks, the Zen monks and the Buddhist monks, they still do other forms of yoga and still do hatha yoga exercises.
Mm-hmm.
But their goal is meditation.
When you're talking about mind-body connection and yoga as, you know, benefit to improve this mind-body connection, I'm thinking that most diseases, the root cause of diseases is this mind-body disconnection. So when you reconnect them and you get everything in balance, this is when you are experiencing better health and vision reverse.
So I think the word alignment in yoga is very much used. You go to studios and everybody talks about alignment. And most of them refer to align your bones, your ligaments, to align your vertebrae. But alignment means to align your mind with your emotions and with your physical body. Because we live in a world where we have jobs we put our physical body into and we hate them. Our mind tells us we should do something and our emotions tells us to do something else. Mm-hmm. And we are living in continuous disconnect and unhappiness because we cannot have a job we love and fulfills our emotions and minds. We do things which are totally brings us to this disconnection, to this imbalance. And then at the end of our life, and we said, why were we so miserable? Why were we so sick? Because we hated everything we did.
Or it's yoga deficiency. Maybe they should practice more yoga, right?
I say so. I think everybody should practice yoga. In my case,
about business. So what do you want to say?
I said that everybody should practice because I saw in my case and people I grew up in my yoga and people in my family who did not practice yoga and just follow a regular life. And after 30 years, I can see the differences. And I can see how a person who practices yoga and makes it a lifestyle, it has much more balance and harmony in all aspects of life. And these problems with the difference between emotions, thoughts, and physical body and all these disconnections, they disappear. And eventually you live a life you love. And then you're happy and healthy.
Now, talking about this, because you practice yoga and you have clients and you have your own business. Tell me if you have any advice for someone who would like to be a yoga instructor and would like to start a business. Is it hard? Is it easy? Because obviously it's going to be something that he or she would love to do, right? If it's her passion.
I think yoga, first of all, should be made a passion. And I think, how to say here? Yes, it is a business, but I think you should put your passion first. Because yoga, it's a devotion job where you want to help people. You want to help them grow. You want to help them overcome their limitations. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, not always, that is rewarded financially to its value, let's say. And I think if you want to start a business at the beginning, making like as a part time, what actually you can blend it with something else you do, so you can support yourself while you build up your business. Mm-hmm. Because if you go yourself totally in this, and it will be hard to make money a lot from the beginning because it's such a big competition. And depends what you're teaching. Maybe some people are lucky enough and they teach a style that everybody loves and they just explore right away. But from my experience, it is because it's a devotional, devotional job and you don't need to, you can help people only if they pay you. Sometimes people come to you, call out problems and you just help them because you want to help them get out of the situation. And they might not have money to pay you, but I personally still help them. I don't measure.
Yeah, the same for my consultation if they don't have, absolutely, yes.
Yes, and that's why I'm saying from the beginning, just start it as a part time, and as you go along, see how you can support yourself from it. I personally don't want to depend 100% of yoga because I want to be able to teach it the way I like it, and I don't want to change my standard just to make the money. Just to make money, I want basically. To be able to keep the quality of my teachings to the level I want, and I don't want to depend on the income of only the yoga classes. Mm-hmm. And in this situation, because I have money to support myself from other sources, then I can say I'm teaching these things in my way because I know that's practice and experience for 30 years of me, and I know it works. And if you tell me if I come into your studio, I have to teach something else because that's how we bring people in, then I'm sorry, and I do something else.
Tell me about nutrition advisors. How do you blend in? So you have clients who come for yoga and you're also a health coach for them?
Yes, and I think these are very, very connected with each other because yoga is a lifestyle. It's a unity with everything what is nature. And mm-hmm. we want to be as natural as possible and obviously to eat whatever natural possible, as natural as we can. Mm-hmm. And that's why we recommend to eat organic. We recommend to become vegan or vegetarian. Mostly some people want to become big vegan. We recommend all kinds of juicing and detoxing. Actually, we're teaching classes, mm-hmm. Methods of detoxing. We teach a lot of nutrition about food, macrobiotic diets, and about wheatgrass and wheatgrass juice and stuff like that, because a yogi, it has to be healthy. And to be able to meditate, which is the almost final goal in yoga, or to be able to reach the ecstasy, which is the samadhi in yoga, you have to be healthy to feel good in your body, to have state samadhi in your physical body. How can you stay have state in samadhi when you have a liver toxic and gives you cirrhosis? A person with a cirrhosis cannot enjoy life.
How can you reach your full potential if you're in pain or tired, or you have brain fog, or you need
exactly
to take care of totally. And nutrition is big on
absolutely that. Yes, nutrition is as important as the physical exercise in you, because you cannot meditate if you don't eat a clean food, because it makes your mind foggy.
So if you have a meditation, totally, it causes brain inflammation if you eat inflammatory food. Now tell me a little bit about meditation. For how many years have you been meditating, and how many hours can you do it? What's the maximum you can do, you've ever done?
So I meditated right from the beginning, because we learn meditations like the Lai Yoga I told you, which is similar to TM, Transcendental Meditation, 6 months into the program. So I was right from the beginning, and I started to meditate using mantras since then. So I can say I also meditate for about 30 years. And you can do it as much as you want and as much as you're able. Because
how many hours? Tell me, in your case, what's the maximum?
10 hours, 8 hours.
10 hours?
Yeah, 5, 6, 7, doesn't matter. Because we have yoga camps, we have special meditations during the year and stuff, where meditations are very, very long. Mm-hmm. And you do it. I personally did for very many, many years, 1 hour of meditation on the third eye, a specific meditation. And I did it absolutely daily for years and years and years.
Do you think that naturally are able to meditate without putting so much effort like we do? Mm-hmm. Think about the pets, like dogs and cats.
Yes, let me tell you the story with my dogs, because my dog is a very hyper dog. He's a fox terrier. He likes to chase and run a lot. And I had him as a puppy, like 6 weeks old, and I meditated with him in my lap from since he was a puppy. And from the very hyper dog, he was able to stay still with me for hours to meditate. It was just unbelievable. He absolutely was feeling it. And then the dog I had in Romania before I left, she was sick as a puppy. She had parvo, which is a disease which kills dogs. Uh-huh. And actually, I meditated with her in my lap for her health with specific mantras and things to stop her disease, and she healed. And it was just it was like a miracle happening, because the doctor didn't give her too many chances. Mm-hmm. So absolutely, they are sensitive to energies. I notice it, dogs and cats and birds. Absolutely.
I think as that we are wrapping up, it was very interesting, but tell me if there is anything that you would like to know for somebody who wants to know more about yoga. What would you like to tell her or him?
I want to tell them that yoga is much more than physical exercise. It's way much more. The physical aspect of yoga that you see in gyms, in general, in any kind of fitness club, it's just, let's say, a scratch into the surface of yoga. I would not even call it, honestly, yoga, because yoga, it's a way of life. And it's a spiritual path. And it's a spiritual science. Basically, it's a science.
A Vedic, and right?
It's coming, is what?
A Vedic science?
Yes. It's a Vedic science. It's extremely precise. So if you find the right instructor who is actually trained and initiated in the secrets of yoga, they can actually build a map for you, exactly tailored and designed to your own needs, that you can develop and grow up as a human being to be unrecognizable in a few years. I don't care what the problems are. I really don't care what the problems are. You can transform fantastically with yoga if you do it rightly, correctly, by somebody with the help of somebody who knows it. So yoga is not just a physical practice for the body to look good. It's a spiritual science.
And you're able to adjust the exercise is based on their, let's say, mobility, right? If they have
absolutely. Yoga needs to be practiced correctly, not perfect. Because it's important to do the best you can with the ability you have than to not do at all or to break yourself in pieces to try to arrange it. Because if you put yourself in the hospital with a broken leg or a broken hip, you're not, it's not any help. Actually make you sick and
stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So do you do any coaching online or just in your area?
Our classes are mostly live classes, but we will start, actually we'll start some classes online, which will be live classes for now online, probably the beginning of next year.
Very exciting. So if people want to reach you, where would be, tell me your website?
Yeah, I have a couple of websites. One is Ophelia Mohr, M-O-H-R, and Ophelia is spelled with S, not a P-H, O-F-E-L-I-A, Ophelia Mohr.
Just like your first and last name, and maybe you can put the link down below.
Okay, Ophelia Mohr at .com and omnutrition.com.
Okay.
And to omnutrition.com, then actually can send me emails through that website.
Perfect.
Ophelia at omnutrition.com.
So you're going to start with online courses and classes, yes?
Yes, in January probably. Our school, I don't know if it will be me, the teacher, it will be probably my friend, but it's exactly the same style, and probably when she's gone, I will suffer her and we'll help each other. So it's exactly the same thing. Will be classes designed mostly for the North American populations.
And you have special classes for seniors?
I teach yoga in a retirement community. So I have people there from ranges of 70 to 75 up to, I had actually a 100-year birthday celebration in my class a few years ago. And now the oldest one.
The oldest? She's your oldest student?
I used to have it, yes. So she passed away a few years ago. But now I think the oldest in my class is probably 95.
And the youngest?
Probably around 72, 75.
No, youngest in general, like your youngest student.
Oh, gosh, I had even children in my classes. Probably I had a mother who was coming with her daughter. She was not even in school yet. She was probably right a year before she was going to school, probably 7, 8 years old. She was 7 years old, I guess.
Wow. So let's wrap things up. So let's summarize. So the benefits of yoga, so the huge one is the mind-body connection. If we are looking at the feelings and emotions, so less stress, less anxiety, less depressed mood, right? More focused, more able to concentrate.
Yeah, the resistance to tiredness is very important. The ability to resist.
Resilience?
The what?
Would you call it mental resilience?
I would call it mental relaxation and awareness, increased awareness.
Awareness, okay.
Yes, but yoga gives you a lot of energy to do things. It gives you a lot of vitality, which is very important because a lot of people suffer of lack of energy.
And then it's healthy for your heart. Yes, it's great for your joints.
For all organs, it's healthy. Yep. For absolutely all organs.
Okay, so for your overall health. Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome. So,
and also, the yoga is a spiritual path. So it's not only for your physical body and mind and emotions. It's also for your soul and for your spirit. So.
maybe I think this alone would be an episode alone to talk about the spiritual part.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, so thank you so much, Ophelia. We're going to talk again about the research studies because this ancient form of therapy and way of living actually is backed up by research studies. And there are some serious studies that are confirming the benefits. So are really cool, and I think many people should be aware of them. There's a reason why I started actually to go to meditation, because I was reading so much research, I said I have to try it. So probably other people would be interested to know about the research behind it too. And thank you so much, and I'm looking forward to talk to you again.
Thank you so much, Brindushat.
Bye-bye.
Bye.